Hey, how you doing? Richard Bryce here today. I want to talk to you about the wrist lag. I want to show you how to create it and really how to time it with your hips, because that's going to be one of the most important parts of making it work on a high level. But I also want to talk about maybe some limitations and reasons why you want to be careful when you're using wrist lag. So I hope you find this video helpful. If you do, it'd be great if you could give me a thumbs up. And if you haven't already subscribed to my channel, it would be great if you could do that as well. Okay, so what is wrist lag? Well, wrist lag is the name that we give to the position of the wrist as you bring the racket forwards into contact on the forehand. And the reason it's called wrist lag is because it comes through last. We are going to fire from our hips, then our torso, then our shoulders, and the wrist is going to be laid back behind, and the racket comes through last of all to contact. Now, the name can be a little bit misleading because there isn't actually going to be too much work going on at the wrist. Your wrist only does certain movements. It does this and it does this. Well, the position that we're going to get into, if I'm in a good ready position, I hold the racket like this, my contact point is the same. So I'm not actually changing too much about the wrist as I do this. There's going to be other body movements that are really important, so that's what we need to focus on. But first, let's very quickly talk about what we're trying to achieve. You'll have done a unit turn, which you know about. Your body is ready in position, torso facing the side for a neutral stance. My feet are going to be positioned like this. Your racket is going to be up, some variation of this depending on the specifics of your technique. You're then going to fire through the hip. The racket's going to go back into this position. We're going to be talking about this. Hip, then the torso, then the arm comes through. This creates that position that you see so many of the pros in. This is the racket lag position. And then it comes through to contact. And then there's the follow through. So the power and the spin come from this. They come from the rotational force, the forwards racket head movement, and then the upwards movement of the racket. And it's that combination that we're trying to achieve, and the racket lag is an important part of it. But there are two different types of racket lag, and I also want to talk about something really important for preventing injuries. But the two different types of racket lag are going to be based on whether you use a straight arm or whether you use a bent arm to hit your forehand. Both of them work. Federer and Nadal use a straight arm. A lot of the other pros use a bent arm, so you can hit amazing forehands with both variations, but there are subtle differences that we need to talk about here. For the straight arm variation, before you take the racket into this position, or before the racket goes into this position, the arm is going to straighten, because normally the take back, the arm is going to be bent, it then has to straighten before dropping back. So when you're beginning, you might do that just kind of artificially. It's like the pat the dog technique. So you might go from this position, straighten the arm, and then work on this movement. But as you progress, it's going to be a simultaneous thing where the arm straightens and the racket goes into that position. But the key is the timing of that movement with the hips. So it's the hips that start the drive, and you have to allow your arm to relax so the racket drops back and the shoulder externally rotates. So for the straight arm variation, this positioning of the racket comes from shoulder external rotation, but I'm not using my muscles to do it. I'm just relaxing as I drive my hips, and because things are pulling forwards, I'm pulling on the butt handle and it's just dropping behind. And this is going to turn your body into a whip. It's going to use the elastic in all of these muscles, so then you can fire the racket through really quickly. So we've got the racket head speed, and we're reversing that shoulder external rotation and now internally rotating it to create the spin. So that is the straight arm variation, with external rotation to get into the position, internal rotation to create the spin. The bent arm variation is a little bit different. Instead of just shoulder external rotation, we're now going to be using more of the forearm, doing this movement to create the positioning. So this movement is called supination. So rather than just completely relaxing the arm and the whole shoulder externally rotates, now there's a tiny amount of muscular effort. So it's not, you're not forcing it into position. It's still very relaxed. It has to be relaxed. But we're going to have shoulder and wrist external rotation still timed with the hip, so that now we end up in this position, and then it's still hip, torso, arm, and we're contacting with a little bit more of a bent arm. And then the spin comes from a combination of shoulder internal rotation, but also a little bit more reversing of the forearm movement, creating the pronation. So now it's more of this motion. And again, it's like a whip. And I think one of the best examples of turning your body into a whip is Jack's sock. His forehand's a little bit different, but you can really see this whipping-like motion, insane power and insane spin. So it all works, but the key is about getting the timing. The timing of the hips, remaining relaxed, allowing things to lag behind, and the timing of the sequencing of the body movements and the coordination of the body movements relative to the ball that's coming towards you. And that's going to be a big piece of the puzzle as to whether you can make this work. And this is where I want to kind of talk about injuries a little bit, because if you're hitting the ball late a lot of the time, there is the potential that you might damage your wrists with these forces. So be careful as you work on your timing, because timing is going to be really important. Now, I've got a full video that breaks this down. It talks about the vision in detail, and it talks about the coordination of body movements in detail. I'll place that link in the description so you can check that one out. Here, I just want to mention that when it comes to the visual stuff, you can train your visual system. You can improve your ability to judge the speed of the ball coming towards you and how far it is away, so that you can have better timing on these. Firstly, to help prevent injuries, but also to improve performance, whichever one you class is more important. I'll place a link to that free vision program down in the description, and I'll place a link up there in the corner. So hopefully this has helped you to understand the racket lag a little bit more. But before I close out the video, I just want to let you know about a fantastic resource by Dr. Brian Gordon. He has done a wonderful breakdown of a bunch of different pro style forehands on his website. I'll place a link, because I learned so much from him. So a lot of what I've explained here for you, I originally learned from him. So I want to give credit where credit's due, because he's done a lot of fantastic work. So I'll place that in the link in the description as well. Okay, hopefully you found this video helpful. If you've got any questions, I would love to hear from you. Leave them down below in the comment section.